It was so small that it was smaller than the period at the end of this sentence. I'm confident I have read that in a textbook.
I'm sure you have.
Right?
And it's not actually how it works, and we're going to come up with a better one by the end of today. Welcome to another installment of Wife Reacts. This is my wife, Awkward M.
Hello.
Let's start with, what do you know about cosmology?
Cosmology.
Yeah, like the Big Bang specifically.
I don't really know much about the Big Bang. It was very fast, very hot.
Okay. What I want to spend some time going over today is some of the like misconceptions that we kind of run into.
Okay.
With the Big Bang, things that people sort of misinterpret.
Mm-hmm.
And then we'll see where the conversation takes us.
I'm excited. Let's get into it.
Okay. The main opponent to this idea, his name is Fred Hoyle. He was a huge proponent of the steady state universe, the universe that doesn't ever change size.
Okay.
The term Big Bang, ironically, was coined by Fred Hoyle.
Oh, no. I'm a little offended by that.
He was giving a radio interview in 1949.
Mm-hmm.
Good old Fred says, it's absolutely ridiculous. They expect us to believe that the universe started in some kind of Big Bang or something. You know, I'm paraphrasing here, but that's essentially how it went down.
See here.
Yeah.
Some Big Bang.
And it just caught on like wildfire.
Mm-hmm. It's like there was a gap. You know what I mean? And he filled it and everyone was like, thank you.
Yep, that's the one.
Yep.
You hear it and you're like, that's it.
There's a part of me that kind of appreciates that it was Hoyle, though, because it's not like he didn't know. He knew that he named it.
He did.
You know? And that's something that he had to live with.
One time during an interview, he said words are like harpoons. Once they go in, it's very difficult to get them out.
Brutal.
Unfortunately, the term Big Bang causes all sorts of misconceptions. Like, it makes people think that there's an explosion when there isn't. The Big Bang was not an explosion.
Okay. This is new information.
This is a very common misconception.
Sure. Every illustration that I've ever seen in, like, a textbook or anything else makes it look like an explosion.
Yeah. In fact, there's this one particular animation from NASA that shows all of these galaxies zipping out of a single point, and it's not actually how it works. An explosion is matter expanding into space. The Big Bang was space expanding and just taking matter with it. It's different.
Yeah, sure.
There is a different kind of pattern.
Yes.
To be fair, they do start very similar when an actual explosion first happens. There is some uniformity to it.
Mm-hmm.
And that uniformity is very similar to the uniformity we see in the universe. But that's only true right at the beginning of the explosion when it's hot. Very quickly, the matter becomes turbulent.
The matter becomes turbulent in an explosion.
Correct.
Okay.
And it doesn't appear to have done that in the universe.
Okay.
The pattern that we see in the expansion of the universe, specifically the expansion of space,
uh-huh.
which is a very important clarification.
Yes.
Is not explosion-like. It doesn't look like an explosion.
Mm-hmm. And so it needs to be described differently so that we can describe it correctly.
Yes.
Yes.
Imagine you have an inflating balloon.
Mm-hmm.
And you've, like, taped some paper galaxies on the balloon. As the balloon inflates, these galaxies move farther and farther apart along the surface of the balloon.
Mm-hmm.
Another analogy is, like, baking a loaf of bread, a rising loaf of bread. And so inside this bread, maybe you've got, like, raisins or something. And the raisins represent galaxies. As the bread expands,
okay,
the raisins move farther apart.
So this one's different because it's talking about volume rather than surface area.
Right. I like this one better because it's a little closer to like what's actually happening. Because our universe is three-dimensional. It's not on the two-dimensional surface of a balloon. It mm-hmm. is three-dimensional. These things are just moving apart.
Right.
The grid of space is getting larger.
Right.
The galaxies are just being carried along with it.
That makes sense.
Right.
It's reasonable.
And then there was this Belgian physicist named Georges Lemaître. And he asks a very specific question. He's like, okay, so space is expanding. What happens if we turn the clock back?
Ah.
We just keep rewinding it. What happens?
Yeah.
Maybe the universe was really, really tiny in the distant past.
Sure.
That it started from a single point.
Mm-hmm.
And it expanded from there.
Right. I would like to take a moment and say that all science begins with a good question.
Yes.
Yes.
But Lemaître proposed this idea that maybe the universe started very, very small and very hot and has expanded and cooled off.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't go very deep into it.
He doesn't have to have the entire explanation for it. He asked it a question, and then he came up with a proposed solution mm-hmm. that the rest of the physics society can run with.
Right. A question I get a lot in the comments, just a lot, is where did the Big Bang happen?
What an odd question. I've never thought about that before. It didn't happen anywhere, or it happened everywhere.
Is this when things start to be unintuitive? Because we want to think of the Big Bang as an explosion, but it wasn't an explosion, right? It was space itself. All locations themselves, starting small and getting larger.
Right. And there's just nothing in our like realm of understanding that works like that. Because if you think about like blowing up a balloon, or if you think about a loaf of bread rising, if you think about anything to try and describe the phenomenon, it has an origin point. And so unintuitive would definitely be the way to describe it, I think.
Your next natural question might be, well, where's the center of the universe?
It's wherever you are.
Right.
Right.
There are a couple different ways to describe the word center.
Mm-hmm.
But the easiest way is to describe it as equidistant from the edge.
Yeah, sure. Right? I think that we would agree with that.
It's kind of like a circle is equidistant from its center.
Sure.
You know,
mm-hmm.
same thing with the surface of a sphere and so on. And so I think that's probably the best definition we can come up with.
Mm-hmm.
But at that point, we're just exchanging one question for another. Like, where is the edge?
Do expound.
We have something called the cosmic event horizon. If there is a galaxy beyond the cosmic event horizon and it emits light now,
mm-hmm.
that light will never reach us in the entire future of the universe.
Okay. Because it's moving too quickly.
It's moving too fast.
The other direction.
Correct.
Okay.
If light from beyond there can't reach us, then nothing from us can reach there either.
Sure.
It is a hard line.
Mm-hmm. No communication.
Right.
Shall occur.
The interesting thing is, this is not the last horizon that we have access to.
That is interesting.
We have something called the particle horizon, which is the farthest that we can see right now.
Which is surely not beyond the cosmic event horizon.
It is way beyond.
It's not based on the information you just gave me.
You got to be very careful about the wording here, right? Mm-hmm. The cosmic event horizon was the boundary at which if light left right now, mm-hmm. it couldn't reach us. That doesn't mean that light that left in the distant past couldn't reach us.
Oh, for goodness sake.
And so the particle horizon is the farthest objects or matter that we are capable of seeing based on light that left in the distant past.
So is this the microwave background? What's
yeah.
it called?
The particle horizon is a little bit beyond that.
Uh-huh.
But not much.
Okay.
It is possible for us to receive things slightly farther than the CMB, the cosmic microwave background.
See, I knew there was another letter.
Yeah.
Thank you.
But we've only preliminarily detected it, like very recently.
Detected what?
Like gravitational waves.
Ah, I was like, what could you possibly be receiving that's not light?
And so there's also a gravitational wave background.
Yeah, this is new, right?
Very new,
yeah.
Like in the last year.
Yeah. Are they on this side or that side of that 46 billion number?
They should be on this side.
Okay. Because it's not light. We're not seeing them. If we're being careful with our words.
But gravitational waves also go with the speed of light. They also have that limitation.
Okay.
And so this essentially represents the edge of the observable universe.
Naturally.
Right. We know that the entire universe is bigger than that.
How? How do we know?
It's a very good question. We have things like gravity and weirdness and non-uniformities and stuff on our scale, on stellar scales and black hole scales and even galaxy scales. But when you get to a sufficiently large size, like a billion light years,
mm-hmm.
things start to look very, very uniform. This mm-hmm. is what we call the cosmic web.
The cosmic sponge.
Right. You can see that matter's kind of clumping together in these superclusters, and then there's huge gaps in between. But if we zoom out more, it ends up looking like this. It ends up getting really uniform.
Sure.
I mean, you can tell it's a little splotchy, but like it's approximately uniform.
Yeah.
We expect the entire universe, right? Not just the observable universe, the entire universe to be infinite. There's no reason for us to think that uniformity is going to just stop at some edge. But every experimental measurement has an error. There's an experimental error associated with it based on the techniques and the equipment that we have available.
Absolutely.
And this is no exception.
Naturally.
What that error gives us is a lower bound. We know for sure that the entire universe is at least 20 times larger than the observable part.
Based on our models and the potential error.
Correct. Now,
it is somewhere between 20 times larger than the observable universe and infinite.
Correct. And obviously, that's a big range.
Yeah. I mean, it's just big.
Right.
It's just big. And so
there's
we
more
said
universe.
The part that we can see was what, 40 billion?
46.5 billion light years away is that edge, the particle horizon.
46.5 times 20. Can you do that math on your head?
It would be 930.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
How? Did you already look up that number before?
No.
Okay.
930 billion light years as a radius.
Mm-hmm. As a radius.
As a radius.
Not as a diameter.
Correct. Radius.
It's so big.
So what is that? 1,860?
Yep.
Yeah.
1,860 billion.
Mm-hmm. 1.8 trillion light years in diameter. Minimum.
Minimum.
If that's the case, if it is 20 times larger, then we start to get into weird things with edges. If the edge exists, then you could easily take the definition of a center and find the center of the universe.
Naturally.
It still wouldn't mean the Big Bang happened there. The Big Bang still happened everywhere. But you would be able to find a center to the universe. And that itself isn't a problem necessarily. But the edge is a problem. Because then you have to ask yourself, like, well, what happens after the edge?
Right.
Nothingness? Does it just stop? It doesn't make a whole lot of sense. We don't really know what that would mean physically.
I don't even know what our analogy means physically. So, yeah, I can imagine that you don't know what to do with an edge.
We acknowledge that it's possible that it could be smaller.
Uh-huh.
But we just say that it's not. It's infinite and move on with our lives.
Sure. And it makes the most sense.
We've had to kind of reevaluate what we referred to as the Big Bang. We used to think the Big Bang was the event where space began expanding.
And it was so small that it was smaller than the period at the end of this sentence. I'm confident I have read that in a textbook.
I'm sure you have.
Right?
We can't necessarily assume that there was a moment like that.
Mm-hmm.
And so when we say that something happened during the Big Bang, we're just talking about like the early portion of the universe.
Mm-hmm. We're talking about inflation.
Yeah.
When we talk about the Big Bang.
There's a whole period of time that we refer to as the Big Bang. It's not just a single moment.
Interesting. There's a period of time where space very quickly expanded.
During that time, a lot of stuff happened.
Uh-huh.
A lot of different things. Mm-hmm. Particles coming in and out of existence, forming quarks, soups, and
hydrogens.
Hydrogens eventually.
About that in our
right.
Last video.
And so, like, if something happened during that period, and even like for a sizable portion after that inflation period, like mm-hmm. all of that early universe is referred to as the Big Bang.
That's interesting. I didn't know that.
Yeah. The term includes that entire period.
Interesting. This is brand new information.
Right.
Does this bring our video on cosmology to a close today?
I think it does, yeah.
Holy.
I don't know how long this video is going to be, but we've been recording for like
he's gonna
almost 2 hours.
He's going to snip this down to like a 10-minute video.
2 hours of conversation.
A breakdown in the middle. It's okay to be a little crazy.
How can all protons be from the Big Bang? What about neutron decay? Look, I appreciate the pedanticism, but nuclear physics is very much a probabilities game. Neutron decay isn't common enough to matter when we're talking about all the protons. It's close enough. Anyway, thanks for watching!